हरमन सर, सचिन सर, शुड वी स्टार्ट?
यस मैम, ही इज कम, ही जस्ट वाइनिंग वन और टू मिनट्स।
एम आई ऑडिबल?
गुड मॉर्निंग। यस यस यस, गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू।
मॉर्निंग सर।
ओके, सो डॉक्टर संदीप, काइंडली स्टार्ट द सेशन।
Okay, very good morning everyone. On the behalf of Department of Mathematics and Statistics, I welcome you all to this event to celebrate National Statistics Day. And also I extend my warm welcome to today's speaker, Dr. Rajiv Balakrishnan Karandikar, who is a well-known mathematician, statistician and anthropologist. He has served as the director of Chennai Mathematical Institute since 2010. Also, he is a fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences and Indian National Science Academy. Now, first of all, I request our senior assistant professor of the department, Dr. Sachin Kumar, sir, to please formally welcome our guest and participants. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, Dr. Sandeep, ma'am. Our worthy vice chancellor, Professor R.P. Tiwari ji, and DI Professor R. Vasurika ji, DSW Professor V.K. Garg ji, Dean Research. Dean and associate deans of all the schools and HODs of all the departments. Very good morning to all of you. Today we gather here to celebrate the birth anniversary of Professor T.C. Mahalanobis, who is a recipient of Padma Vibhushan Award. Every year we celebrate his birth anniversary as a National Statistics Day. So on this occasion we have with us distinguished Professor Rajiv L. Karnadikar. Presently, he is the director of Chennai Mathematical Institute. And I heartily welcome you, sir, on the behalf of all the fraternity of the Central University of Punjab. Over to you, ma'am Sandeep.
Okay, so thank you, sir. Now, I request you all to please stand up for the university and. I request Dr. Ashok Kumar Pathak sir to please introduce the speaker. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. It is my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker. Professor Rajiv Lakshman Karandikar is a distinguished professor in the area of mathematics and statistics. He is also a well-known anthropologist. He has been in the Chennai Mathematical Institute since 2010 and served as the director of the institute. He won in the 1956. After completing his BSc from Indore University, he pursued his MStat and PhD from Indian Statistical Institute, Kolkata. After completing postdoctoral research from University of North Carolina, he has served as a professor in the several reputed institutes of India. His area of interest is probability theory, stochastic processes, application of statistics, and cryptography. He received various prestigious awards like Young Scientist Award in 1985, National Award for Statistics in the honor of Professor C.R. Rao. Professor Karandikar is also recipient of the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in the 1999, which is one of the highest award in the India. So Professor Karandikar has a lot of the experience. So without taking much more time, sir, we are very fortunate to have you today on this occasion. So I'm inviting to Professor Karandikar, sir, for today's lecture. Sir, over to you, sir. think sir has left.
I think उनका disconnect हो गया.
Just wait. I think there is some technical issue. Should I call?
But sir, kindly call.
Okay.
First unmute. Oh, sir. Unmute yourself, sorry.
नंबर नहीं लग रहा है, मैंने मैसेज किया, मैसेज देख रहा है सर.
ओके.
संदीप मैम, आप तब तक या तो डिस्प्ले कर दे जो पैम्पलेट है से स्क्रीन शेयर करके.
सर का मैसेज है मशीन शट डाउन, गॉट शट डाउन. ठीक है, स्टार्ट कर रहे हैं. ठीक है.
Okay, sorry for inconvenience.
संदीप मैम.
जी सर.
यस मैम, प्लीज डायरेक्टली कॉल टू सर वंस ही जॉइनिंग फॉर द लेक्चर.
I think sir has joined back.
Yeah. I'm sharing the poster, okay?
Yeah, I am back.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
The star or silence, total silence. I was wondering what is happening.
No, sir. So we are very fortunate to have you today on this occasion.
Yeah.
So we have already briefly say something about you. So sorry for the inconvenience.
That's fine. No, don't.
You may start, sir, please.
Okay. All right, so let me share my screen. So first of all, let me thank you for inviting me. And sorry for this confusion, but that was not in my hand. The laptop's scratched, something happened, and yeah. Wait, let me share my screen. Where do I? Yeah, so of course, it has been said that today we are celebrating the Statistics Day, and I was debating what should I speak on, and I've chosen to speak on role of statistics in the era of big data and analytics. So as you all must be aware that these two phrases, big data, analytics, they have been very much in the news for last at least 10 years. And a lot of people who have had nothing to do with statistics have entered these areas, and they now wonder whether statistics has any role in these. We can do it without statistics. And that is what I'm going to address on. I don't agree with that view, and I'll be explaining why I feel like that. And very much important for statistics students to be aware of this, that if they are asked this question, that what has statistics got to do with big data and analytics, today we can do it without statistics. You can use some of these examples. That is the idea for this theme. Okay, so I have heard often that with tons of data available, who needs statistics? Why do we need models, inference, and all that? Data analysis and artificial intelligence alone with the data will give all the answers needed. So all they think is that all they need is a package like SAS or R or any of the other packages, shove the data in and they will get all the answers. That is what is the common feeling. And while it is true that statistics evolved as a science in an era where the amount of data available was small and efforts were on to extract maximum information out of that. Okay. So we might go back in time, and the evolution of statistics, we can kind of say that it was around 1870s to 1920, that 50-year period. First 25 or 30 years, little development, and then next 20 years, boom, lot of development. Okay. But in all this, the availability of data was small, and efforts were to extract maximum information. If you go back into a book which was written maybe 50 years ago, certainly books which I read through, it would give a table for T statistics up to 30, and then after that it will say for T bigger than 30, the data is large and you can as well treat this as normal. Well, you can treat it as normal is fine, but data is large. So that was the view that if you have 30 or more data points, your data is large. Today's students will laugh at that. But forget the semantics of what is large, what is small, but we will discuss why today also statistics has a role. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to illustrate by examples that while some techniques may no longer be relevant, the concepts are as relevant in this era as they were then. Statistics concept. Not all maybe, but several. Okay. All right. So first, let us start with the question. What does data science or big data analytics, data science, what do they refer to? What do they mean? Okay. Now, different people have different views on that. Here is my view. data science refers to taking data from some domain and discovering relationships amongst different elements on the data and use the same for the understanding and of the underlying phenomena. That is what is data science according to me, and the other two phrases are more or less the same thing. I mean, different people use different phrases, that's about it. So you have data from some domain, it may be large, it may be small, and you use that and understand that and discover relationships amongst various variables and understand your phenomena better. Okay, so let's start with some examples, and nothing better in today's time than starting with vaccines. So from data on vaccine trials to determine if a vaccine is good enough for usage or for prediction of a difficult to observe variable based on observable variables. So the first one is a concrete example, other one is a very generic one. So after all, companies develop vaccines and then the government agencies have to decide whether or not it is good enough. How do they do that? There is no technique, there is no theory as which will illustrate that such and such vaccine is good. Most of the time, it is based on statistical trials. You try it on a few people and then based on that outcomes thereof, you decide whether it is good enough or not. And that is certainly a problem with small data, and certainly not large data as what today people think that data means it should be a few million data points. If they have to wait for a few million data trials for a vaccine, then the whole population of the world may be dead. So they have to move very fast. It may not be 30, but it may be 100, it may be few hundred, it may be 1,000, but not certainly millions. Okay. There are many other examples where you want to get data and make a conclusion about something which is difficult to observe. So for example, we all know, I hope you all know, that drinking and driving is a no-no. You are not supposed to drive a vehicle if you have had a liquor. Now, you may say one should not have liquor at all. So I'm not saying you should have liquor, but given that several people do have liquor, then at least what you have to do is you're not to drive when you have had liquor. Now, how do you decide this? If let's say somebody is having, after having a drink, somebody takes a, is driving a car, how does one police, and a policeman stops, they think that some person may have had a liquor and is driving. How can the police prove that the person is actually guilty? And the law says that the alcohol in the blood should not exceed a certain threshold. That is what the law says. Okay. Now, imagine if the policeman is there with a syringe and wanting to draw out blood from you, if you are the one who was caught, and they want to decide whether or not it has alcohol, what percentage of alcohol. Now, that will be disaster. So, instead, what is done is, so this is a difficult to, this is an example of a variable which is difficult to observe, nearly impossible to observe for a policeman who has caught somebody at night while driving. Okay. Now, what was discovered earlier by someone was that alcohol in blood is strongly related to alcohol in the air that you breathe out when you are breathing. And so they developed a technique to measure the alcohol percent in the blood, in the breathe out air, and based on that make a judgment about what, how much alcohol is there. Okay, so this is a very concrete example. A difficult to observe variable is alcohol percentage, blood percentage is in, alcohol percentage in your blood. Easier to determine is alcohol percentage in the air that you are breathing out, and the two are strongly related. Not 100%, but strongly related. And believe it or not, this is how it is used. Likewise, there can be you may be getting images, and you want to decide whether or not a person appearing in an image is someone who has been earlier ranked with either terrorism or theft or beating up people or whatever. Okay. The police has these data. Okay, anybody who is once somebody is taken to a prison, then they take mugshot, as they call it. So they take an image, and now based on an image that they have obtained in a particular event, they want to decide whether this image corresponds to somebody who has already been charged earlier. So you want to classify image. You want to identify whether these two images are the same. They belong to the same person. The match may not be exact, but statistical techniques can be used. Now, these kind of problems have been dealt by statisticians over the last 100 years. One difference now is, while earlier the data was few hundred or at most few thousand data points, today it could be millions. And that is where the word big data comes. With small data, one had to use statistical model and then deduce the conclusion. Do we need that in this era of big data is the question. Now, the first thing to note is that while in several contexts, we have tons of data, not all problems where we wish to draw conclusions or inference from data are big data problems. Okay. There are tons of problems which have only small data available, not millions in any case. So opinion polls and quality control are two contexts that come to mind when the data is not big. So in my introduction, it was said I'm also known as a sophologist because I've been doing opinion poll analysis in India for last more than 25 years now. And that is certainly something where you don't have millions of data points. However, people may say dismiss that if you try to give this as an example where even big data is not available, but you want a conclusion, they say, some people consider this as frivolous activity and not worth talking about. So forget opinion polls, but let's say quality control. Now, quality control is another area which has small data, certainly not millions of data points. And quality control has played a major role in making and breaking companies in the last 100 years. For some of you may know, but not everyone, that using quality control techniques with vehicles, with cars, was one of the major reasons for the big success of Japan after the World War era. In World War, Japan was devastated, and then they rebuilt, and then they used quality control techniques, many of that they had learned it in India, elsewhere as well, some of it. And then, while India was only teaching and not implementing these, they actually implemented it in the manufacturing car, and then the Japanese cars became big in US, so much so that the car manufacturers, the car companies in the US in the 50s and 60s after the World War era, they were the equivalent of what are Google and Apple of today. Okay, the technology companies in US which dictate everything. So in that era, it was the car companies, and these companies didn't go bankrupt, but they became very, they lost a lot of money, and they had to really struggle. And all that was because Japan could sell cars which were better at a cheaper price. And how did they achieve that? They achieved it using quality control. So you can read about it. I'm not going to go on and on about it, but you can certainly see quality controls, cars, Japan, US, and you can see that how quality control played a role in making and breaking companies. All right. And we are waiting for COVID-19 vaccine for a long time. We had been, and then we got a few, and then there are many more which may be coming. And the process of approval and acceptance of vaccines, indeed all drugs, not just vaccine, but is based on what is called RCT, randomized clinical trials. And these involve few hundred, at most couple of thousand observations, certainly not millions. And importance of this can no longer, you don't need to stress how, why it is so important today. Okay. We all know that. So this alone is enough to say that statistics relevance continues. Okay. The idea of randomized clinical trials is actually borrowed from what is called design of experiments. Some of you may be doing courses on that. And these were introduced to study agriculture to determine the best combination of fertilizers to utilize on the field. And writings on this theme are a cornerstone of statistical inference. Okay. In any case, one of the biggest problems faced by mankind in recent times has only a statistical solution, and it will have to be based on small data points and not millions. So this is enough for us to say that statistics is relevant. Now, but let us now move on to situations where we actually have large data set. So if you only stop here, people will say, okay, so once you have a large data set, you don't need statistics. Not true. So these days, there is a tendency to just take a chunk of data and process it through some statistics or AIML engine, that is software, and get conclusions. Well, in my view, before we start to push the data through an AIML engine, we need to ask questions about data that have been given. Is the data representative of the population we have in mind? So, a lot of people, non-statistics people, if I say this, they say, "Ha! Once you have millions of data points, who cares? Just do it." Well, the connect with the data point, I mean the population and representability. Let's examine this one. So let's say Republic TV and NDTV, both these news channels do a poll. As you know, if those of you who watch news channels or go to their websites, they every day have a poll on their right hand side somewhere. Okay. And then once you vote, then they'll say, okay, so many percent people said this, so many percent people said this. Okay. And it's very likely that the two may yield different results. Especially if it's a political question, then they are likely to use different results. And the reason is that poll in Republic TV is likely to be biased towards the government, and the same poll on NDTV is likely to be biased against the government. And this is to do with the audience that both these sites attract. There's a lot of writing about this, that how do you choose which channel will you go to? It's not that those who are in the favor of government will not go to NDTV. They know that NDTV may not be so favorable to the government, but occasionally they will go to NDTV, and often they'll go to Republic TV or another TV which is in favor of the government, and vice versa. Okay. So, either of these two groups, the regular visitors to Republic TV or to NDTV, none of them represent the entire voting population of the country. And therefore, if you make your judgment based on only one of these, you are not going to make it. So these are not representing the data. This data is not representing the population. Okay. So, as I said already, that I have been using, I've been involved with opinion polls, etc., for a long time. And especially once we had crossed 2010, a lot of people, friends and seniors and so on, scientists, have suggested to me that I should give up, in their view, my old fashioned door-to-door sampling technology. They said, you studied it when you were a student and you are using it, it's okay till now, but from now on, give it up and just start using social media. That is the way to go forward. There are people who have already moved in that direction. Okay. Now, I'll just point out that if in 2014, where Mr. Modi and BJP won the election hands down, if I had taken social media data at face value, as it is, the conclusion would have been that BJP and allies would win over 400 seats. They did win large, but not 400. And why am I saying this? Firstly, this is my observation. I was already tracking these, but not using it. And it is very easy to explain, because firstly, which is the population which is using social media? And now we are going back to 2014. Today things may have changed a little, but 2014. So the younger, richer, more educated urban, each of these characteristics is kind of together. Those who matched several of these are the ones who are using social media a lot more than the rest. And indeed, they don't represent India's population. It is true, based on my observations, based on actually door-to-door sampling method, that in each of these four groups, BJP was more popular. And therefore, it is no surprise that on social media, BJP showed far better performance than in the actual. Okay? But there are other aspects, but I will skip that for now. But the point is, the population tracking social media is not representative of the population we have in mind. What is the population we have in mind? Voters in India, because that is what will decide who will win and who will lose. Right? So that is not representative of the population. Now, people have asked me, how come the same social media data is used to predict sale of, say, iPhone or Pixel? And they say that involves money, so obviously that must be you. Good. Well, the point is that the social media users essentially they represent the target market for these products. So if I was given a task to predict which kind of people are likely to buy the next iPhone, I'll go with social media, no problem there, but not for elections. Okay. Then comes another question. Once we take data from some source, we need to know and factor in as to how the data was collected before we can begin to draw conclusions. Now again, people ask, why do you need to know how it is collected? Data aa gaya hai, I'm not asking you to pay money for how it was collected. Why do you need to know? Well, those who follow news would have seen last year, in May actually, that in a paper published in Lancet, a very well-known journal for medical world, they published a paper in May 2020 which on HCQ, hydrochloroquine. And their conclusion was that hydrochloroquine is not useful in treating COVID-19. In fact, it may be worsening the situation. That is what this paper said. They claim that it is based on data from large number of countries and large amount of data and blah, blah, blah. And because Lancet published it, the very next day, WHO stopped clinical trials involving HCQ. Hydrochloroquine is something which is used a lot in India for malaria. And in absence of anything else, it was believed that HCQ may be useful. And certainly it was being used as a preventive. So for frontline warriors, they had nothing else to give them, the doctors or the cleaning staff or the police staff. And they were all being given HCQ. And immediately Indian media went on that, WHO is stopping HCQ. The Indian government doesn't understand. They are continuing with HCQ. actually ICMR study showed indeed that HCQ is certainly useful as a preventive, and they continued to give. So several people were looking at this HCQ data on Lancet, and I also was involved with a few others. And there were many issues with the statistical analysis in the paper. Okay, that is what I discovered, and I wrote about it, that they had not factored in as to how patients were chosen who received HCQ treatment. So imagine that the HCQ is the only treatment available, and each hospital is publishing data on how many patients were brought to the hospital, and among those who got HCQ, what happened, and among those who did not take HCQ, what happened. And you just say that, oh, among those who got HCQ, they were worse off. So they published this. Now, the thing was, to really conclude whether HCQ was useful or actually worsening, we had to factor in how the hospitals chose who will get HCQ and who did not. For example, it is entirely believable, indeed natural to do, is that those who are coming in with symptoms, they are more likely to get into trouble, and therefore you give HCQ to those coming with symptoms, and all the others who are coming without symptoms, you know, relatives, people who stay in the same flat, etc., etc., were also going to hospital, they were not given HCQ. And if this were so, then the even when HCQ was better treatment, the conclusion shown in the Lancet paper are likely to come through. So this is telling you that just taking data is not good enough. You need to figure out how, ask questions about various aspects involved in the data collection. So you should see, those who want to see more on it, they should see a Wikipedia article on what is called Simpson's paradox. And this goes back to actually Carl Pearson 1899 and Yule 1903 writings, okay, as to why this kind of analysis is important, this kind of questioning is important to conclude whether or to conclude a statistical judgment. Okay. So what is Simpson's paradox? So let us recall a case from 1973. UC Berkeley was accused of using gender bias, of being biased against women. And this was based on, somebody did this same kind of analysis that, okay, you look at all the women who applied and how many of them were selected, and how many men applied, and how what percentage was selected. And this was for graduate school. So the data showed that 44% male were admitted and 35% women were admitted. And just by itself, people concluded that they are biased and went all over town. Okay, the statisticians at Berkeley, of course, you know that Berkeley is one of the major places where statistics is developed and studied, and a lot of major results have happened there. So the statisticians there were very upset that how can their institute be into this? They are so positive institute. So they decided to identify which departments are actually the culprits. So what they did, they obtained data for each department. How many people, men applied, percentage, how many women applied, percentage selected. When they looked at this data-wise, department-wise numbers, what they saw is very interesting. The next page shows data from the six largest departments. There are many more departments, but just to illustrate. And so department names are not given deliberately. And this is data from this Wikipedia. So six departments, in four cases, the percentage selection amongst females is actually larger. So in four out of six, actually a higher percentage of women are selected. In two out of six, larger percentage of men are selected, and that should not be leading to a conclusion that there is a bias. you can go on and on about this particular data set. And what you can see, though, is that the departments where the selection percentages was high, very large, very fewer women applied. So while higher number of women were selected, it did not show up in the final data. So department A, 64% are selected. So A and B are where percentage selected is very high. And in both of them, the percentage of women who applied is far less than percentage of men who applied. And that alone explains the final weird data, that final list that we get, that higher percentage of men were selected than women. Okay. So do read Simpson's paradox and where this also comes up. So here the department can be called a confounding factor, and not having information on the department can give you twisted outcomes, conclusions. So back to the Lancet paper. So this symptomatic or asymptomatic, this data is like a confounding factor, and not having that could have influenced the final conclusion. This is also called omitted variable bias in economics, econometrics literature. The Lancet paper had many other problems, and eventually they had to withdraw the paper and so on and so forth, but the damage was done. So the point is, in an RCT, it takes care of such factors and allows the various things to avoid this kind of events. In the so-called observational study, that is what was the basis of the Lancet, such choices should be recorded and taken into account in analysis. And failure to do so, you will get into trouble. Okay, so I have argued as to how the data was collected and what variables were missed out and so on and so forth is important. So we have seen that, but knowing these will also reveal if there is a selection bias or censoring bias. So what is a selection bias? In an exit poll, okay, so all you know, those of you who may follow opinion polls and so on, they would know that on the last day of a phase election, all channels go on air with what they call exit poll. So what is exit poll? People are sampled based on the day of they are finished their polling and are voting and are coming out of the polling booth as they are exiting the polling booth. That's why the name exit poll. Now, the enumerator, if they choose only people who are more educated, simply not for any reason, other reason, just that, you know, it will be quick to finish the analysis. For the same time, he would have larger data. And the payment may be based on how many interviews he or she finishes. So therefore, the incentive would be to, you know, just look at people and decide who are more educated, who are likely to answer your question, rather than keep asking, what do you mean, what do you mean? If you do that, there is going to be selection bias, because the educated people may vote differently than the uneducated people in terms of which party they vote for. Censoring bias. So let's say dealing with data on deaths due to cancer among the patients who have been diagnosed with cancer. If we ignore deaths due to other factors and infer that those who did not die out of cancer had recovered from cancer, for example, then the data set would certainly reveal weird answers. And this is what is called censoring bias. So the people who died out of something other than cancer, that data is censored. You simply do not know that if they had not died out of heart attack, would they have recovered out of cancer or would have become worse? Now, this is something which has been well known in statistics literature and statistical studies, and lots of techniques are been developed as to how to deal with censored data, because you still need to figure out, you know, the effect of some medicine on cancer and so on and so forth. So these two biases, and if you are simply, you just take the data at face value, whatever is given to you without asking these questions, you are going to be doing any of these biases. The other classical statistical idea that remains as important as ever is that correlation does not imply causation. Indeed, correlation itself may be spurious correlation by coming up because of some confounding factors, or it may be unrelated. So, recently, several papers have appeared which report, and now this was perhaps prepared some months ago. So, if you let's go back in time about 4 months, when the before the second wave in India of COVID, okay, after that picture has changed somewhat. But at that point, several papers were reporting that countries with higher GDP have higher death rates, deaths per million due to COVID, compared to those with a lesser GDP. Even with the second wave of COVID, the death rates in India are still less than in the West, but 4 months ago they were much less. Okay. Now, so these are correlated. So can we really conclude that if a country has higher GDP, then it's more likely that people will die out of COVID? Seems absurd almost, because higher GDP may also mean better medication, better various things. So this can be explained by confounding factors such as age profile of population. It is known that higher age groups are more susceptible for death, and people with higher GDP have a higher death rate and higher percentage of people who are old. So that could be one reason. They have higher urbanization index, and therefore urbanization index also is related with COVID. And there are other factors which I don't go about now, because I can't explain why sanitation has got something to do. Sanitation could be a confounding factor. I have written a paper about this with Dr. Shekhar Mandan, the DGCSIR, in Current Science a few months ago, and you may try to read that. But many confounding factors can explain, and just concluding that higher GDP means higher death rate is wrong. Okay. All right. So we have discussed, I have explained as to why the following statistical ideas are important. Asking, is the data representative of the population we have in mind is important. Is the data subject to some selection or censoring bias? Has any important factor that may influence the outcome being ignored? And remembering that correlation does not imply causation. All these, as you may recall, you are all statistics students, most of those at least, and somewhere or the other, some course or the other, such things may have been said, may not have been stressed as much, but they are all covered in statistics teaching. And people without statistics background are completely and blissfully unaware of all this. So, what else one should remember? Okay. It's now fashionable to indulge in what I call pure data-driven analysis. So, possible pitfalls of pure data-driven analysis. some of which we have done, some more. And nothing like an event which actually happened, rather than say that it can be like this and that. So now we go back about 150 years, at least almost what I call the beginning of statistical development. And I'm talking of someone who has played a big role in what in statistics development, but here he was in error. Okay. So Sir Francis Galton, a cousin of Darwin, was studying inheritance of characteristics, and based on experiments on sweet peas, had concluded or observed that he came up with a hypothesis that daughter seeds were likely to be closer to the average seed than the mother seed. So sweet peas is something which the period of getting a next generation seed is small and therefore easy to actually conduct experiments. And what he found was that even if you start with seeds which are all much better, much higher size than the average, the daughter seeds, the next generation seeds, are going to be not as good as the original. And he postulated that the same would be true in other characteristics and for humans, including intelligence. And that is what was concerning him, because he was ultimately trying to talk about intelligence and making all kinds of conclusions that unless you do something about it, the intelligence will keep going down. Percentage of intelligent people will keep going down, etc., etc. Now, to study this hypothesis, Galton studied heights of father-son pairs. He studied, because height is easier to measure, and sons, I'm talking of grown-up sons, so it's not that child, small. So what he observed was that if the father is taller than average, then the son will also be taller than average, but shorter than father. If father is shorter than average, then the son will also be shorter than average, but taller than father. And he called this regression to mean. Regression is actually a negative connotation word. Okay. And we know that regression is the most popular statistical technique used in any kind of analysis. And I often wondered that why a negative connotation word is used for the most popular statistical technique. The reason is this. Galton had a little different. This is not exactly what Galton had done, but I've tried to, for a lecture purpose, I've given a suitable version. Okay. So Galton argued that perhaps the same will be true even for all inheritance attributes, including intelligence. So perhaps a valid conclusion from data-driven analysis point of view. This was the basis of a subject, what was called eugenics, developed by Galton, started by Galton, now forgotten. Do read about eugenics on the web, Google, out and out racist ideas. So one wrong starting point can lead to disaster. In fact, I talked about Carl Pearson, and you would have read about Carl Pearson and his things in statistics. So Carl Pearson was the first eugenics professor in University College London, follower of Galton, and some of the things they wrote were so racist that there has been a movement now to remove these people from all kinds of memorabilia which was there in that university about them. Some roads named after them, hostels named after them, lecture halls named after them, and they all have been removed now. So, do read about eugenics. But going back to Dalton and his analysis about regression to mean. Dalton had only a few hundred observations. Now today, say we obtain data on passports, say Indian passport data, and we look at father and son pairs amongst them. So there will be large number of people whose father has also had a passport, and both their heights would be recovered, recorded, and we can obtain that. Now, perhaps few hundred thousand data. If we push all this data into an AI/ML engine, it will give you the same conclusion as Dalton had. If you ask the same question, look at tall data, fathers who are taller than average, what happened to their sons? And okay. However, the same data, whether you take Dalton's data or the passport data, if we try to predict the height of father based on height of son, the conclusion is going to be diametrically opposite. If the son is taller, then the father is likely to be taller but shorter than son, and vice versa. And it may appear like it's something wrong with statistical ideas. How can you get two diametrically opposite ideas, conclusions from the same data set? Well, I'm sure all of you have had a course in regression, and you would have seen that there are two regression lines. Predicting Y on X and X on Y, if you drop both these, they are going to be two different regression lines. And that is exactly what is happening when you are predicting father or son respectively. So, Dalton was so convinced about his idea that even though it was pointed out to him, he refused to look at this and continued to hold his belief and kept writing about it. So, between Galton and Carl Pearson, many ideas can be traced to them. And yet, they made this big error. So, pure data-driven analysis is a no-no. You have to look at the whole picture. What is it the data on? What is it that you want to predict? Is what you are doing really predicting what you are looking for, etc., etc.? So, another example where pure data-driven analysis led to a weird conclusion. In 2007, during the Cricket ODI World Cup, a techie team at one of the analytics company in Mumbai, at that time it was a new company, now it is a big company, and perhaps they didn't have enough contracts, so a team there who were already employed, they were told by the bosses that okay, do something by which we can publish and get some benefit on. So what they did, they looked at ODI data, entire ODI data is available on the websites somewhere. Ball by ball, who is the batsman, who is the bowler, where was the match held, etc., etc., what was the outcome, every ball. Okay. So, what they did was that they tried to predict outcome of the matches which were to follow in the World Cup. And indeed, in each team, they picked a few good batsmen and they wanted to predict how many scores they are going to, what would be their score on the match. Now, in the opening match, and this is all you can check on the web, I mean, this is not the story I cooked up, this is actual event. Event in which I had a small role, as you will see later. So, on March 13th, the first match between West Indies and Pakistan, the data-driven model developed by the analytics company, they predicted that West Indies is going to win. And they predicted the exact score of the two captains. Inzamam ul Haq 36, Brian Lara 37. They put on their website, they sent it to some newspapers, some of them published it, etc. As luck would have it, all these three things exactly happened. Not only West Indies won, But Inzamam ul Haq was out at 36 and Brian Lara 37. And the kind of thing which came out next day, the company got a lot of attention in the media, and some of their team members and their team boss, they went on talking on and on and on about how they are going to, you know, all cricket thing is now going to be. However, the model went for a toss in the later matches. None of the, some of the winners had a match, but the prediction of individual outcomes of players, none of them matched anymore. Now, I know the company, I know the CEO of the company, and I visited the company a few weeks later, a few months later. And the CEO asked me to go and talk to the team because they're very, they're zapped as to why their tech model failed. They wanted to understand. And I told the team that nothing is wrong with their model, but the best that any model can do, indeed any statistical model can do, is predicting the stochastic variable about the what is the score of the, let's say, West Indies, what would be their score, or what would be the score of Brian Lara. Now Brian Lara's score is going to be a stochastic variable. Nobody knows beforehand that exactly how much he will score, but based on the past data you can have that, okay, it may be somewhere in this range and more likely here, more likely there, etc., etc. So the best it can do is to give conditional distribution given by all your observed information. Now, if you analyze that, you use it in a data set, use the data set with some software, and instead of conditional distribution, what it is going to do, it is going to predict average or mean or median. And if you take that as the truth given by your data, then you are going to be in trouble. So the best that your data can do is to give you the mean of Brian Lara's scores in the next few games, not exactly what he's going to score in the next game. And if you are unaware of that and you just do pure data-driven analysis, all kinds of things happen like this. So if they're using simple multiple linear regression, and that will give the conditional mean, while if you are using least absolute deviation, it will give the conditional median. And statistics, all statistics software will give you error predictions, error estimates, or standard error of your estimate. If you ignore that and only read the main thing given, then you are in trouble. So when I talking to the statistics team about this, one of them actually said to me, "Sir, here you are telling us that we cannot predict precise outcome, but you go on national television and predicting election outcomes. How is that okay? And what we are doing is not okay." So, good question, but I had to tell them that, look, if your model had predicted that Brian Lara's score is going to be 37 with probability 70% and more, with at least 70% probability, then it is okay to make that prediction, and more or less, by and large, you are going to get many successes. But if only you have is that the conditional mean is 37, that is not the same. So there is a difference, and that is what happens in opinion polls and predict election outcomes, at least the methodology that I do. We will go with confidence about something if our prediction is says that party or this group is going to win with probability 70% or more. If it is only 55-45, I would say that difficult to predict, too close to call, things like that. Okay. All right. Let me move on to this theme. I'm going to share this PDF with the department, and you may see those who are interested in opinion polls and so on, they can I have given a link to an article, longish article I have written on this. Of course, you search with my name, Opinion Poll, on Google, and you will get many full lectures on YouTube also. All right, so let's move on to another aspect. Some people claim that once you have a huge amount of data, models are not important. You don't need to model, you can just use the data. If you have followed other things that I've been talked about. Well, my own view is the following. Those who do data analysis, etc., and apply it in real world, they all are aware of what is called GIGO. Garbage in is garbage out. So data is important. If you give bad data, you are going to get bad output. My view, equally important is GMGO. Garbage model will still give you garbage output, even if your model, even if your data is good. So once again, I'll refer to actual data, an actual event. So during World War II, and World War II, remember, was early years of use of aircraft in warfare. Okay. So British Air Force aircraft were doing sorties over Germany for bombing. And the casualty rate for the aircrafts was high as they were shot at. There were no specific anti-aircraft guns, but people were, the aircrafts were flying low and people were using standard machine guns, aiming at the aircraft and shooting and hoping for the best. So several aircrafts were falling down, several aircrafts were returning through, though they were hit by bullets. Now, on this again, you can read a lot on the websites. So based on naive analysis of data on locations where the planes were being hit, it was proposed to the British Air Force that armor, that is, you should somehow do something which will improve the aircraft in the areas where, which are showing high amount of damages, high amount of hit. Okay. So the conclusion was that this is where maximum hits are taking place. So make it better, make that area better. So armor is something which you do to the metal, which will improve the whatever. Now, again, I hope most of you have heard about the name, Sir Abraham Wald. So he looked at the problem from a very different point of view. He was, of course, American, and he was working with the team which was working with the US defense. But by the time this happened, US and had joined the war, and US and UK were allies and they were sharing all such things. So he came up, this was routinely briefed, shared, and he read at it and he saw something is wrong about it. So he looked at it from a very different point of view. When I'm saying he argued, no, this is there in large documents. So this is my take after reading those documents. So he argued that there is a selection bias in the data. Only the aircraft which returned or which survived came back, and only that data is available where they were hit. You do not have data on aircraft which fell and did not return. So classic case of a selection bias or censoring. And that has to be factored in, otherwise your conclusion can be false. Then he created a model that was, that model, bullets were being fired at randomly on the aircraft and were not and they were not targeted at any specific part of the aircraft, and the effect of hits on a given part or given area was independent of the effect of events in any other part. Now think carefully about these two. They were relevant in the 1940s, the era of World War II. Today, both would be false. because you have anti-aircraft guns, they can precisely target it at a point. They can target precisely at the tail, it can target precisely at the engine, and so on and so forth. But that was not true then. Likewise, but as you all know, that there is redundancy on various things in aircrafts. So if you are flying on an aircraft which has exactly two engines, you can be assured that actually the engine is capable of flying with just one engine running. And the second one is there just as in case one of the engines goes down, the aircraft will still come back to Earth. So that is redundancy. And then the assumption two here, or the in this model, will be false. That if one thing is already gone, the other one getting it will mean it will fall. So it's no longer independent. But in, again, those days, there was no redundancy. All right. So under this model, the surprising, or maybe not so surprising, conclusion that comes up is the following. That you need to strengthen the areas where you are having less or no damages amongst the files, which amongst the aircrafts which you have observed. And the reason is simple, that under this model, all areas are kind of almost equally likely to be hit. And the parts where you are not observing any hits in the aircraft which are coming down, the explanation is, ki wahan lag gaya toh it is going down, therefore you are not observing. And where you are seeing lots of hits, ki wahan lagkar kuch nahi hota hai. So once you come up with this analysis, once when you think about it and create this model, that you need to focus on areas where you are seeing less or no damages rather than the areas where you are seeing largest damage. Another important point is that when Wald analyzed the data using that his model, one of the conclusions that came up with low hits and hence needed reinforcement was the engine. This made a lot of sense. And recommendations were accepted by the Air Force right away. So here is another important aspect, that if, let's say you take up a statistics job and you do fantastic analysis and come out with a conclusion, and you are asked to go to the board of directors of that company. They are, you are focusing on your techniques and theory, and so and so has written this technique and I have analyzed it, that is what it says, etc., etc., will not cut the ice. You can mention it, but your focus will have to be on something which they understand, which they can buy. If you have no such thing, then you are in trouble. So you have to the presentation to the board of directors or to the general public has to focus not so much on theory, but by analyzing something which are easy for them to digest. Okay. And if they are so easy to digest, then no explanation is needed. They will just accept. So the takeaway is that importance of domain knowledge and building a good model. So, now a statistician may or may not have domain knowledge of the area, but interacting with people who have domain knowledge and believing in each other and exchanging ideas, this is a very, very important part of using statistical techniques in any real application. And once you have understood the domain, now you build a good model and use it. So, in my view, the statistical model is an important part of the data interpretation exercise. Indeed, the underlying model is the connection between the data and the objective of your conclusion. The model gives us the right frame of reference for interpreting the data. If you have the right frame, you will get the right conclusion. And if you have a wrong frame, too bad. So only when we have the appropriate model would one get the full intelligence out of the available data. Okay. So, So I'd like to conclude by saying that the statistical ideas and concepts evolved over the last 100 years have a role to play if we are to use the data that we have to make, to draw an actionable, valid intelligence. May not be in all situations. In many situations, somebody who doesn't use any of these techniques may come with the same conclusion, but you will be far more confident because the other side is going to make falter, at least in several cases. So, if a case, if the conclusion is important for you, you better have this background with you. So, I think let me stop here and I'll be happy to answer questions. As I mentioned, I'm going to share this PDF with the department, with Dr. Ashok. And, but now I'm ready to have questions, answer questions if you have it.
Does anyone have any query?
Thank you, sir. I think Professor P. Ramarao would like to say something.
Sure. Yes, good afternoon, sir. It is, I enjoyed your talk, especially I am more actually towards pharmaceutical sciences. I enjoyed your examples, RCT, as well as hydroxychloroquine, fundamentally. You said out of out race for another point. I say out of out, the big pharma has killed the hydroxychloroquine.
I wanted to say that. I didn't say that, but because reason is
so much data is coming out afterwards. Yeah. Which actually diagonally opposite. I have in fact written a review article on this one. I would like to share. That is one point. Second thing, your points are very valid with respect to COVID data. Because I was looking at it, there is a very different pattern when you said actually the deaths versus the GDP versus on the deaths, whatever the point you have mentioned, especially the food habits and certain drug use we have not taken into consideration, because the drug use is one of the major points in India where immune suppression is taking place. On the other hand, there is one drug which actually do not suppress the immune system. On the other hand, it improves it. That is cannabis. If you verify this particular data, yesterday I was talking with someone, because UP, Bihar, and these two Madhya Pradesh, these are the people who use religiously the systems daily, the bhang or cannabis. Is actually having a very low rate, significantly lower rate. But the data is not available, sir. I have actually tried in all hospitals. Are they keeping a right data on this? Nothing is available. Anyway, I enjoyed your talk. And the biostatistics is one of the most important aspects.
Yes.
Unfortunately, in India, it is not actually coming up like anything. This is my opinion. I'm not a statistician, but I teach statistics for my purposes. So thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. I still want to interact with you on my observations, sir.
Please do. Please do.
In fact, take your email address. Please permit me to talk with you.
Please. Most welcome.
Multivariate analysis is essential. So many factors are coming in, sir.
So I got involved in this area of biostatistics and COVID data and so on and so forth, because the DGCSI, Dr. Shekhar Mande, is an old friend of mine, and he has been the one who is writing to me about statistical ideas, or what is this, what does statistics say, what people are saying, is this right, wrong, etc., etc. So
I really appreciate your idea. I enjoyed your talk. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Please, thank you, Professor Piramahe.
Yeah.
Over to you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Does anyone have any query?
One of our
from the audience,
MSc student Mohit Lamba, I think he would like to say something.
Please go ahead,
Mohit.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, it is nice to hear from you. Sir, as we know, in recent times, data engineers is a big thing in analytic roles. So, yeah. Are they a threat to big data analysts or data scientists?
I don't think so, because but what happens after 20 years, very difficult to predict. Technology is something where lots of people have made false predictions about the future. But all we can say is that whether they use technology or whether they use people, statistical ideas will remain important. And if you suppress them or bypass them, you are going to make errors, whether it is technology or whether it is people.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Dr. Sandeep, kindly continue.
Okay. So thank you very much, sir, for giving an enlightening talk on role of statistics in the era of big data analytics and data sciences. Who's there? Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. All right, sir, so which will be certainly helpful for all of us. We are grateful for the time and effort you took to share your thoughts with us. Thank you very much. Now I invite Dr. Harmanpreet Singh Kapoor, sir, to please propose a vote of thanks for this event.
So, good afternoon, everyone. It is my privilege to have been to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I am Dr. Harmanpreet Singh Kapoor, and on the behalf of Department of Mathematics and Statistics, Central University of Punjab, I am here to present the vote of thanks for today's webinar. First of all, my sincere thanks to Almighty God for making today's event a grand success. On behalf of Central University of Punjab, I would like to thank our today's speaker, Professor Rajiv L. Karindkar, Distinguished Professors, Chennai Mathematics Institute, for enlightening us with his knowledge. Today's webinar was full of knowledge and interesting things. It gave a deep insight into the role of statistics in the era of big data analytics, data science, and also revealed some interesting facts. I am pretty sure the precious knowledge that professor gave us will definitely help students in their studies and research. Once again, I would like to thank professor for giving out time for his busy schedule and enlightening us with this knowledge. Thank you so much, sir. I would also like to thank Professor Ramakrishna Vasurika, Dean in Charge Academics, for giving permission and motivating us to organize this webinar session. I want to thank Dr. Ashok Kumar Pathak for inviting Professor Rajiv L. Karindkar to conduct this webinar. I also want to thank all faculty members of the Department of Mathematics and Statistics who really work hard to make this event successful. Also, I thank you to all students for paying attention. Once again, I want to state that we are grateful to Professor Rajiv L. Karindkar for being with us. Thank you very much, sir.
Can I add few sentences?
Yes, sir.
So there was quite a bit of delay on my part in accepting the invitation. And let me explain the reason. Actually, I was hit by COVID and in a very bad way. I was hospitalized. Okay. I could not understand written words. And I could not answer emails. So I was in very bad shape. And that was in the month of May. And in June, slowly things were improving, but I was not sure whether I'll be able to give a full talk. And that is part of the reason for the delay. Thank God, thankfully for the Almighty and for all the well-wishers and for everybody who has helped me, that I'm almost not quite normal. Some of you may have noticed that occasionally, I was faltering in reading the word. So it is because still the old thing is still not over. Yes. But if it was 2 weeks ago, it would have been much worse. And 1 month ago, I could not have given the talk. So.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much for giving this lecture. Sir, in the near future, we will also like to hear from you one lecture on the exit polls, whatever your interesting lecture. Sir. That is very interesting.
Sure, I'll be happy to give.
That is
on opinion polls and so on. Over this period, I have given maybe at least 150 lectures, several of them available on the YouTube, but I will be happy to come and give here, not issue.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir. Now I request you all to please stand up for the national anthem. Once again, I thank you all for your active participation in this event. Thank you very much.